The deep sea, the oceans, huge domains at depths of thousands of meters, cold with little light and only slow water movements. Still, a very important domain for sedimentary systems. What processes are taking place there? What kind of sediments do we find? Do you remember the topography of the Earth? We've seen how more than 50% of the Earth's surface lies at around 4,000 meters water depth. These are the abyssal plains, huge domains, of which we know very little. You've seen this slide before. It shows the four main components of the marine domain: the coast, the shelf, the slope, and the abyssal plain. A domain of key importance is the photic zone, which corresponds to the water column which can be penetrated by light. In this water mass, photosynthesis is possible, and huge amounts of quantities of microorganisms, mainly plants, exist, called nanoplankton. The nanoplankton forms the first ring of a full food chain, which eventually make it possible for large organisms to live, such as whales and sharks. Once they die, all these organisms will start sinking through the water column. The soft parts will be oxidized, consuming oxygen and producing a low oxygen layer. The hard parts will be preserved and further sink to the bottom of the ocean. Most of these hard parts are composed of calcite or aragonite. In some cases, they're composed of silica. The trip to the deep ocean floor, however, is not devoid of problems, as with decreasing temperature and increasing pressure, ocean waters become more aggressive and start dissolving the sinking shells. The depth at which all calcite grains and shells are dissolved is called the calcite compensation depth and is comparable to the snow slow line in the mountains. In areas where the ocean floor is shallower than the CCD, a fine-grained calcareous mud is found called calcareous ooze. Sediments on regions deeper than the CCD will be quite different and essentially composed of the siliceous parts of the organism and of the clay minerals we will discuss in the next slide. The other major component of the background sedimentation is formed by the clays and very fine sand grains transported by the winds blowing across the larger desertic domains of the continents. Brought by storms, these light and flaky minerals can travel thousands of kilometers, eventually landing on the surface of the ocean and starting their very slow trip to the ocean floor. Similar to what we've seen for the organism derived from the photic zone, clays will very slowly sink and form sedimentary succession characterized by very low sedimentation rates. These are called pelagic sediments. Pelagic sediments, once they've been lithified, are fine-grained, homogeneous, and very well stratified. Limestone-rich sediments are often white. Silica-rich pelagic sediments are often more colorful, partly because of the fact that they lie a long time on the seafloor and are thus oxidized. If you look in detail, you can see different softer material between the reddish layers. These are the clay-rich sediments, which were blown by the sediments. But sedimentation in the deep ocean is not always calm and monotonous. Once in a while, the quiet is disturbed by the catastrophic arrival of sediments from the shelf. Within a very short time of days, a huge amount of sediments are delivered to the deep basins. These sediment-loaded currents are called turbidity currents and are completely different from the background sedimentation we have described until now. Possibly the first time when these catastrophic events were documented was in the New York offshore, when, with no apparent reasons, the telephone cables laying in front of the New York coast successfully broke. Correlating the break in time with the distance of the cable, it was determined that the cause of the failure must have traveled down deep with velocities up to 70, 80, or 90 kilometers per hour. Seafloor images have then shown that the current was associated with the deposition of large amounts of sediments. The currents responsible for the New York failures and transported sediment to the continental shelf, to the deep basin, we said are called turbidites. Turbidity currents are generated by instabilities at the shelf and the shelf edge, by which large amounts of sediments are mobilized. loaded with the sediments, the turbidity current has a density with a larger than the surrounding water mass and can therefore travel fast along the slope. Eventually, when it reaches the sea abyssal plain, the gradient decreases and the section increases, resulting in a lower velocity. This leads to the deposition of the sediments. In the map view, you can see the different domains and the associated processes. The first order feature is the fan created by sediment transported by the turbidites in the abyssal plain. The shape of the fan recalls in some aspect the alluvial fans we have seen in previous clips, but the dimensions are much larger, often several tens of kilometers. In the upper part of the system, the turbidity currents move fast along the continental slope. Velocities are high and more sediments are deposited. In some places, erosion is important and canyons are formed. Close to the mouth of the canyon, sediments are being deposited and they will show channels and erosive features. Far away, full in the abyssal plain, sedimentary layers will be continuous and with constant thicknesses for kilometers. Indeed, a much quieter environment. And now, let us look at what turbidite deposits look like. Sedimentary layers deposited by turbidity currents have a typical organization called Bauma sequence. This includes great sands at the bottom, followed upward by massive beds, by laminated and convoluted sands, eventually capped by the hemipelagic mud. These muds represent the background sedimentation deposited between one catastrophic event and the other. Turbidity currents are generated by instabilities on the continental shelf and slope and occur at fairly regular intervals of maybe hundreds to thousands of years. With geological time, they form thick succession, developing succession implying thousands of catastrophic events. As you see, the deep abyssal plain is not always as quiet as we expected.